अभी से मैं अभी से मैं सी फंक्शन ऑन ऑफ फॉर फॉर
El hecho de que esa sea tu canción para bombearte me parece lo más deprimente del mundo.
¿Para qué?
Para activarte.
No, realmente es para relajarme.
Que sea living on a prayer me parece.
Ay, cállate, que a usted le gusta hacer Pray Away Journey también, así que cállate.
Ah, no,
que es el mismo.
Journey diferente,
que son héroes americanos. De la mierda, weón. Oye, eso está todo en el.
Cuando esté en el YouTube. Venga, yo saludo a mi hermana y a mi mamá. Un saludo a mi mamá y mi hermana que me están viendo desde Colombia.
A tu mamá. No
entonces sé si un saludo a mi hermana nomás. que Dios te le da mal, no importa que me salga emborracha.
Cabrón.
El amor.
¿Qué? ¿Y te sabes la referencia o no? Ok, porque mi mamá compró la Note 10.
Sí, está.
Ah, ¿quién me habla?
Ah, bueno, bien.
¿Qué? Yo escucho que alguien me habla.
Soy yo, mi amor.
Pero te estás metiendo en la emisión.
Yo no
hola,
sé.
Oye, ¿sabes que tú estás viendo YouTube?
¿Qué le parece, mamón?
Mi amor, tú me metiste por Hangouts.
Ay, yo no sé dónde está este MDM, ya arreglo.
¿Tiene la Carolina?
Sí, es que lo está haciendo por Genea, entonces. Yo no consigo el link a YouTube, mírala.
Dejé dormir, no sea mamona.
Si pecas, se está levantando ahorita, ¿eh?
Se quedó dormida.
Ah.
La computadora tampoco lleva
sí,
mucho.
Mira, no, pero se está transmitiendo eso, ¿no? Ay,
sí.
No.
Ahora escucho todo, qué mierda.
Mira, ¿la pago?
Te roban la cámara.
Ah, que es que no tengo cámara conectada.
Pero es que hola. Yo no quiero que todo se conecte.
Ah, pero es que no salgo acá.
Quiero que vean nomás.
Amor, pero...
No, sí, pero pues yo quisiera poner mi cara.
Que mi mamá
Carolina, no cámbiese la pijama que va a salir con pijama en el video.
Ya me pongo algo, ya me pongo ropa.
Oye, súbete al tercer piso para que el internet no se te caiga.
Sí, ya subo. Espérate, me pongo primero algo.
Sí, sirve. Bueno,
sí, pero weón, no es que no.
¿Qué quiere hacer?
Es que no sé si mamá, la idea era que fuera por YouTube, como el de la noche la tiene, ¿no?
Después no, el link. ¿Y por qué no invita a tu mamá?
Pobre, es que mi mamá no tiene ganado. ¿Qué más se quería poner a mí?
Creo que puedes mandar el link.
Yo traje un poquito más.
Yo traje unos cuantos más.
Están abajo en los equipos.
Ah, tú eres el moderador de la esta. No, dice que tiene YouTube, debería estar en YouTube. ¿Cuál es tu usuario de YouTube? Ay, no,
ay,
no me ayude tanto.
Ah, ya, yo creo que ya, a ver.
Arroba chupi.
Vale. Ah, es que te quiera compartir, ¿no? No sé, mi usuario es... Ah, no, aquí está, lo que pasa es que se ven todos.
Sí, por eso. Bueno, vamos a salir.
Sí, por favor, cada vez que tocas algo se... Sí, mira, entonces, es que se ve, cambia la cámara.
Mi amor, entonces, ¿qué vas a hacer? ¿Lo vas a dejar por Hangout o qué? Ya.
Se va a ir bien. Hoy el tiempo está bien porque nos promovieron uno de los papers, los top 10 papers de bioinformática de la revista. Ya no, no lo fue bien, ahorita mejor.
El presente, pero. Ah, yo quiero saber. Bueno, sí, pero.
100% no, 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 no,
sí.
Estás,
ya, no se acostumbra. Ahí lo estoy viendo. Bueno, voy a pararme. Ya casi me toca.
En el equipo de Pablo, de Eric, todos los pues van a desde el momento de arriba.
¿Cuándo
pasó? ¿Qué te fue lo que me faltó para ñaña? Mira.
Oye, pero si no está pasando nada.
No importa.
A ver, güey, ¿cómo puto se agarró la opinión con la chica de agarrado? Pues, ¿qué hice? Acá se va a dar eso, se lo está. Lo agarró el puto, pero ahora me tornó. Pero lo pillé de mierda. Uy, papá.
¿Se cayó?
Uy,
Nos equivocado. Buenas, mucho gusto, yo soy el hermano de Carolina. This is Chupi's family, and that's my sister.
Why is that?
Hey, hi,
Kelly. ¿Qué le va bien?
Ay, bueno.
Si no le va bien, también le va bien.
Yo no había visto. Bueno,
gracias por el
apoyo. Ve, Caro, mira, mira cómo le queda mi chaqueta.
Ah, se ve muy lindo.
¿Cómo le queda ya? Siempre y cuando no me la vaya a echar.
¿Sí viste la camiseta
que le... No, no te escucho, espera que no te escucho, espera. ¿Qué?
¿Viste la camisa que le regalamos con mi mami?
Sí, que el bobo no sabía por qué le había preguntado yo la talla.
Sí.
Bueno.
¿Ya va a comenzar? Doña Nilda, ¿cómo está?
Hola, mamita, ¿cómo te va?
Bien, sí, señora. ¿Y ustedes?
Aquí, ansiosa, hola, esperando.
Hola, José.
Hola, ¿cómo estás?
¡Qué nervio! ¡Qué nervios!
Mucho. Estamos todos ansiosos esperando.
Sí. Mi mamá está en la oficina y no haciendo sin escribirme. No, ya comenzó, ¿cómo va?
Me imagino. ¿Y la abuelita, cómo va?
Bien, sí, señora. Bien.
Bueno.
Debe andar por ahí. Ve. Voy a ver si anda por ahí. Voy a ver si lo quiere ver. Acá ven, voy a ver.
Pero se va a apretar la llave, tío.
No,
esto
es la primera,
no es la final. Bien, no, está bien.
Yo,
Everyone gets eaten before we start.
Oh, we got to do more. We can stand up here. Let people see you in your suit.
Probably the last time I come to that. Chat?
Okay, so this is Jorge. It's kind of been mine since 2009. He's not that slow of a master student. I supervised his undergraduate dissertation at University of Alfred. On residual logging damage. And he decided to come back, and he was going to do some biomass work for me up until about a year ago, when he went over the handlebars and shattered his elbow and was in a cast for most of the summer. So then I had to find something else to do for him with him. And what we had was this data set, which he has really sort of taken the analysis of on acoustic measurements and estimating stiffness of a fairly large data set. What we're going to do, Jorge is going to give a talk for 35-40 minutes. Then we'll have questions to finish off the hour from the general public. We'll excuse the public, and then we'll begin the examination after that. Okay, right. Jorge, go ahead.
Well, thank you for coming. Thank you for committee meeting members. Oh, 3 years of work resume today, so let's start. Mankind have been used wood since ancient times, even for different kind of properties, like tools, fire, transportation, and of course, shelter and housing. And housing is one of the most important reasons of the uses in the United States. You can see, let's review the production in the United States. In the year 2011, 78 million cubic meters was produced of softwood and hardwood was produced in the United States. Oregon produced around 10 million cubic meters. That's around 12% of national total. 63.5% of those total was used for housing, even though for new build new houses or remodeling. Also, with this housing uses, there is a lot of new wood products that have been used for structural purposes, like laminate veneer lumber, cross-laminate timber, and lumber. Why I mention this here? Because these are products that are commonly used for structural building or our houses. And one of the, and every year there is more demand to build bigger buildings of wood. One example of this is the wooden city in Helsinki. It's in project right now. So they want to build a mix of business and residential buildings. They estimate they're gonna use 2,500 cubic meters to build that city. This one, it will be the highest tall wooden building in Finland with 8 stories. This example, the Wi-Fi building is in London. It's already built, even though it's a Wi-Fi name. It's made of wood. It has 9 stories It's one of the biggest college buildings in the UK. Most recently, I found this yesterday, so it's totally new. This is the tallest, the world's tallest wooden skyscraper that a common architect from Canada are planning to build in Paris. They're planning to build this of 38 stories. So yeah, they plan to build this. So we need, hope we can assure that these buildings are safe. If you compare with concrete and steel, it's a really, think of way really hard to break and badly, because we are used to, at least my country, we are used to concrete and steel buildings. So if you show me a wooden building, it's like, I'm not sure of that. So we have to demonstrate that those buildings are really secure. How are we going to be demonstrating this? You have to measure that the properties of those wood that we are using on the building are the best ones. So we are getting into the wood quality. And one of those measures of those wood quality is like microfluid angle, model color rupture, density, and model of elasticity. These last two ones are the ones that we're going to use in this. Let's talk about density. Density is the most important physics property, because it's also linked to another several mechanical properties. So there's a couple of examples of the values of density in similar woods in the United States softwoods. Brianna pine, ponderosa pine, hemlock, there are similar values also. We had a similar behavior with this. What is important density? We can, as I told you, we can compute different mechanical properties from it. And also, this property is not included in the pre-harvesting inventory. So we know the diameter, the height of the trees, but we don't know the density, the real density. We are assuming one of these values, even of a green, of dry density. So this is really kind of important. We have to try to keep including these kind of food quality variables inside grain harvesting inventory. So density, and the other one I was mentioning was the model of elasticity, which implies, is, in other words, is the stiffness of the wood. So basically what it says is the resilience of wood to bending, to deformation when a load is applied. What does this mean? When I apply a load to to this board, you see it kind of bend, and the idea is like, the visual is like the board recovering its original shape, not break. But if the whole body is like recover the original shape. So there is two, if you go to the literature, you will be find two different mention of modus elasticity. One is the static one, and it's made this evaluation in these kind of machines with a dry board, a 12% of moisture content, really control lab situation. And the other one is the dynamic one. The dynamic one, we're going to use in these kind of machines that are kind of heavy, big, and of course are expensive to get those values of MOE. But the dynamic ones are those values that are estimated by non-destructive methods like I showed you. So one of those destructive methods we can have two groups of those. One of them is using microwaves, like field scan, infrared, spectroscopy, and X-ray to obtain physical and mechanical properties from these studies. And the other group is the one that use acoustic measure. I'm going to use like Bakub, IML hammer, and the HIMA. I'm going to use this one during this presentation for this study. I'm going to explain a little bit more about this. So let's see what the audience. These properties are not including harvesting inventory. We want to promote the inclusion of these properties that can estimate good quality in a pre-harvesting inventory. How are we going to do it? Basically, we are going to develop several techniques that will allow us to predict these values from easily collected data, like DBH, high, or other variables that are commonly used during the pre-harvesting inventory. I'm going to describe a little bit first the sample it came from, the data. we have 510 trees that was around 70 to 75 years old. The stand has been commercially seen 3 times. And of course, it was an inventory, so we have DBH, basal area, volume, height. Well, food core was taken for those for each tree, so we had a measure of food density. And of course, we had the acoustic velocity, bullet with the heat map. So, how this works? We have two probes that are sensors. The lower one is the transmitter sensor, and the top one is the receiver. And there is a small round of mini-heating that the image surveyor has in his hand. So when you heat, when he hits the low sensor, an express wave is coming through the stand, and this one receives that signal. So when this sensor receives the signal, send the information to the previous one and say, hey, it took, I don't know, 1.5 seconds, 2.5 seconds to get the wave to the second probe. So once this one gets the information on how many times took the red wave going to one sensor to the other, it processes and gives you to the to the personal digital assistant the velocity that we are estimating. So that's the acoustic velocity. That's kind of briefly sort of how it works. So again, Harman blow sensor goes out, the third wave goes out, this one receives it, sending by the time it took so, and then it computes the velocity and we are receiving. The good part of this digital system, we can take diameter, stand information, and model the variables in the same way. So we can, in the same sheet, sorry. So we have a lot of information in the same, along with the acoustic velocity there. So now we have the wood density, and now we have the acoustic velocity. So we can estimate the modulus elasticity, MOE, from those. This is the actual formula that we use to estimate the acoustic modulus elasticity when acoustic velocity is involved. So MOE, we use the dynamic curve. It's the square velocity, acoustic velocity times the density of it. This seems pretty straightforward, but there is an issue with density. Wood density is not really, it's really time consuming to get into the wood. So if you are saying we are getting 510 trees, that's fine, but if you're going to have 1,000 trees, it's not really a commercial way to do it. It's not really efficient. It's really efficient. So we think, what about if you can change the wood density for another variable that we are usually do? So the first thing was like, okay, what's going on? Let's build a model, a linear model, changing the density for DBH. We think it's kind of related, there has to be some relationship between them. So let's change it. And also, then I noticed like, okay, but velocity is square. So most of the power of the predictor of MOE is in velocity. So let's compare with a different model, but okay, let's do a simple model. Let's use just velocity and see what's going on. But this part is just trying to substitute density. MOE. What about if we can avoid taking? If, let's say if by law you have to take wood cores to estimate MOE. Let's say, well, I have Monte Carlo simulation. What it basically do is run the whole sampling process different times, 100,000 times. So, and this, in our case, we did it 500 times and then play a little bit better. What is that? These are my 20 sample intensities, and the number of trees what it takes. So in the first round, the simulation took 5 trees from the population and fit this model from those, and then make the estimation, the prediction for the rest of the population based on this model. Again, we are using density in this case because we can't avoid it. And so on with each of the trees. So we repeat. The simulation repeats this 500 times. And how are we going to measure the efficiency of this estimation? Well, we have three measurements here. We have bias, mean and square error, and root mean and square error. To measure the efficiency of the estimation. So, let's work out, because I want to do this whole methodology, let's break up into two parts. One part is like modeling, trying to change good density, or substitute it with another variable, inventory variable, or just doing a Monte Carlo simulation to get the optimal sample size for, with we are using density. So let's see what I get. This the split is that. MOE, there were 510 trees on all of them. There is no missing values. As you can see, MOE is highly variable from 7 to 23. GPA, GPA are gigapascal. It's a precision unit. The mean for population is 13.1. Acoustic velocity is 3.7 to 6, with a mean of 4.9. DBH, if you can see here, DBH are really variable stands. We're going from 15 centimeters to 1.4 meters. And we're going like from trees like this and trees from this side. So this is highly variable. The wood density is pretty close to the to those values reported. And going, it's also highly variable from 3.7, 0.37, and 0.69. Okay. Let's see how the relationship between all the variables and the MOE. MOE, velocity has a high correlation with MOE with 0.86, so that's a lot of relationship as a result of the equation. Followed by wood density, DBH, basal area, and height. In this case, I'm not going to use basal area because it's a function of DBH. It doesn't make sense including that in the model when I have DBH. Total height, when I run the model, didn't work pretty well, so didn't help, didn't improve the power of the variation. We I exclude all the total height and basically work with DBH, velocity, and density. We now have the modeling analysis. When I pick this model, the linear model, the R squared is 0.76, so we had a good R squared, we're good operation value. The model fit was highly significant with the relationship. And also we had the slope and the intercepts are significant. So we had again a good model. And you can see the plot, normality, it's kind of full. Yeah, there's some couple of ripples around here, but they are good. There is a known, I think we are not breaking the normality assumption. The same, the zero plot didn't show any special pattern that we consider to avoid the undoing the wrong model. And of course, the zero, the leverage plot, shows some possible outliers over here that could be due to the variation of the velocity or the DBH. So, we have this first model, and let's update the actual model with the model with actual values. So this is the real model to estimate model selectivity based on acoustic velocity and DBH. So now I wanted to compare what's going on when I took out DBH of the equation and just predict MOE from velocity. So we have the two models. We have the R squared at 0.73 to 0.76. So they start increasing when I include DBH in the model. Again, the slope and intercept are significant, so we are getting the values. But the most important part in this comparison is in here. Again, both regressions go significant, so we are choosing the right model. But the real value of adding DBH is in here, in the mean square error, when we compare that the model one just using velocity have 2,200 value, and the one in the stats include the DBH has a relation almost 50%. So we're not gaining really much predicting power when I include DBH. We are really reducing the variation of the value. So that's a really good model. Not because it is. But yeah, so we are reducing the variation of this almost 50%. So it's a really good one. Now, we can, now we had a model, we had a widget with this model included acoustic velocity and DBH. But remember again, what's going on if I can choose, I can substitute for density, I had to take it. Let's see what Monte Carlo simulation shows. This is a sample of three, six of the 20 sample intensities that I use in Monte Carlo. Y axis show frequency, S axis show MOE, EPA. So this is the mean distribution per sample intensity. What I have to say here is that all sample intensities were really, the mean of each sample intensity were close to the actual value for the population. So it's really good. There is no significant skewness from the distribution. So it's kind of fair data. Let's see the summary table of this. These are the 20 intensity values, the intensity samples. We have the mean. If you can see, it's really close to the actual value of 13.08. Sorry, it's really close, all those values, to the real one. Bias is decreasing, meanwhile we are increasing the sample size as expected. But there is a bunch of numbers. The really interesting part is in these three numbers. Why? Because it's in the part where they're passing through 0.3 to get into 0.25, and so on, they can stabilize the root mean square error and mean square error value. But let's see it in a graphical way. So now you see like the curve is kind of stabilizing, but you know, the straight line right here. And actually the real difference between 7%, 10%, and 12% is not that much. So I can assume that using 10% of the population, I can do prediction to the rest of the world. So what does it mean? What if these three numbers on top of here? So I have 510 trees. Let's say we have budget constraints. So I don't have enough money to take 10%. I can take the 7% of wood density and acoustic velocity to estimate to estimation for the population. So I can take 36 trees and do an estimation. Or the actual optimal sample size that is 10%, so I can take 51 trees. And if you can be a little bit more, you have a little bit more money, you don't know how to spend it, you can choose the 12%. So we can choose the 12% is 51 trees, take wood score and acoustic velocity. So these are really good. Why? Because we can estimate wood properties from a good sample of the population. So we don't need to take census to actually estimate wood properties. So let's see what other people do in similar work like this. Of course, the acoustic velocity was the most important variable when we are correlating with MOE. I got a 1.86. Meanwhile, Lackenbrook, she did a similar study. She got that the wood density was the most important, followed by also for Douglas tree, for Douglas fir tree. The difference is that she used a clean, dry piece of lumber. So we had a really nice and smooth piece of wood. Thing what I'm doing in trees, so this kind of have to account for this variation. I found a weak trend bias between DBH and MOE. What does it mean? Figure the tree lower the MOE. It's not really significant, but it's a thing that was found, also was found by Rabinowski for radiata pine. For my Chilean friend, radiata pine is the Douglas fir in Chile, so they are both similar properties and really nice quality of both. So this is a big importance. This is something we have to get used to that. So we need to know where it probably comes from, this variation, this trend between DBH and MOE. Also, the velocity variation we have to will be due to moisture content on trees. So we have to consider because we are doing on trees, are alive. So depending on the system that we are doing the estimation. The moisture content change. It's not the same during the winter or during the fall. It's more water, or doing during the sun. So this variation in density and velocity could be due to the content of moisture in the tree. My study is when I combine deviation with velocity, we had a good prediction model of 0.76. And also, this is better than found by Paradis and others using a similar linear model for black spruce in Canada. So when I, the deviation which you use, I reduce the 50% the means for error. Also, this thing was found by one in 2007. When they add the deviation to their equation, the mean square also was reduced. And with this study, it's on the optimal sample size for when we can avoid it, taking the measurement of the density of 10%. So when 10% of the population using good force and acoustic velocity, we can make estimation to the rest of the population. If you can see, I'm not comparing this part with any other study because this is the only one. I didn't find a similar study that finds this approach of doing a sampling method to estimate for the population. All things that related the acoustic velocity between the trees on the log has a relationship, or if density and acoustic velocity have a real relationship with model statistics. So I couldn't find any other paper that could be really doing this approach of subsampling the acoustic velocity and density. So, conclusion. Techniques developed show that it's possible to provide inventory data and good properties to estimate good quality. I'll show you we had a when DBH was used, our R square was 0.76. With this model, forestry, forest engineer, people are doing the field can improve their provide with an equation that is less complex and it's really easy to compute most of the statistics that we know quality in a simpler way. This doesn't mean that it's a bad measuration. It's just it's simpler. So we can do it in an easier way. So because we don't lose less time when we are doing the estimation for that. With the Monte Carlo ratio, we show you like 10% is helping the sample size. And depending on your constraint or budget stuff, you can use 7% or even 12% of sample intensity. But if we go beyond the 12%, it doesn't really show a gain in statistical value. So if you take 30% or the 50%, according to my result, you're not gaining any real statistical power in that. So the use of non-destructive method can help you out to the operationalization of the harvest industry. What it means, we can do this non-destructive method meanwhile you're doing the inventory, and it's taking, actually it doesn't take more than 5 minutes. So it's really reliable there. This is also another opportunity for us, for foresters, to provide the better wood quality for the end use. What does it mean? So I can choose the best tree for structure, the thickest tree for the structural use, and send it to the mill for lumber, for cross-laminated timber, all those products that I showed you before. If this tree, if that tree or the stand is not really, is not achieving the quality that we want, we can send it to another user and will be better, more better use than the other result. With this, I just want to acknowledge my committee member, Kevin Boston, of course, he is now going to be like 5 6 years now. Ben, no, a long time.
Ben, almost.
You feel like 10 years, right? Thank you for your patience, all your guidance. Professor Temeskin, thank you so much for all your guidance, your work. So really means me for having you, Dorop, and when I have questions over there. Professor Kaiser, of course, I was your TA 2 times last year. It was a pleasure for me being your student. Also, I learned from you. Then my Homer Simpson when I learned. So I need to bring myself in order to actually learn something. So can you imagine how many times I did this all this stuff before? And of course, Professor Chen, thank you so much for being part of my GTR, so kind of last minute. So, and thank you so much. Alas, well, you can see almost all of you are here, so thank you so much. Prime staff, Maddie, Chelsea, you're the best. Thank you so much for your help. I'm not going to be annoying for all the 2 weeks. I'll be around tomorrow. Of course, the best family in the world back in Venezuela, los quiero, they're watching me now, right now. And of course, my Corvallian family. I just can't say thank you so much for caring me, taking care when I was injured, or happy, especially when I was grumpy. it was been a pleasure to be around with you. Yeah, it was really neat. I like this picture. It's like a really grunge 90s album cover. Thank you so much, and open for questions and comments.
Thank you,
Preguntas y temas.
So, the timber industry, it doesn't seem like it's more utilized in the mill, but how do you see pitching this to timber companies to try and get them to utilize it, and then how do you see it working out to where they could sell, you know, higher quality trees to the mill, and the mill is actually going to, you know, pay for that.
Yeah.
How do you see all that working out?
Yeah, actually, the industry cannot apply it, but they apply it on logs. So when they are in the mill, they use a brother, the Hitman, that it's used for logs. So they measure the velocity in the mill and then sorting according to what. But if we can do this on the field, so we are really not, we are avoiding the process of doing the sorting in the mill. We're gonna do increase the supply chain, so we have adding value from the really early stages of the supply chain. So we have just demonstrated that these kind of tools are really a good possibility for them to improve the quality of the wood and actually add more value to the wood that we are producing. Because of course we have to study when done in the United States, most of them have been doing New Zealand where the tool was developed. In Canada, they're using a lot for the supply chain, So we have to demonstrate to the industry that these kind of studies are really reliable and it's not really highly expensive compared to the power of each time or the time we are spending on the meal sorting the water. It's more like a, there isn't this option, actually it's working. Of course, we need a little more of research. But we can get an added value from the very stage of the supply chain.
Thank you. And so do you think since much of the wood that's being harvested now is really much over years in diameter, do you think your sample went to 1.4 meters?
Yeah.
And so do you think the sample size would be smaller since the diameter range would be more limited?
If you say if you had a more homogeneous population?
Yeah.
Probably.
Okay. Might be able to reduce your...
Probably, yeah. We have a lot of variation of the density and velocity, and a lot of variation of PVH too. So maybe we had a more homogeneous population, so we have a problem.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if we're before learning sample size, yeah. Because at the end, they will have to show if they have, let's say, all of them are around 40 centimeters, so we expect kind of more or less similar values of things of velocity, because it's kind of related also with the velocity, with the pH. Yeah,
so
if you see, you know, a lot of the industry is kind of going to this 40-year age rotation,
mm-hmm.
and if you see this being implemented, how do you think that's going to affect you know, some of the like warehousers that are cutting at 40, and you, that MOE is probably, I don't know, is it probably smaller or a lower MOE because of the
age?
Yeah.
Probably it will be lower because money is like the proportion of juvenile wills with mature wills. So the inner property of the will, which will work out with the account. But with this kind of technique, at least you're assuring that those, the better trees, even though are not the same quality they used to be 6 years ago because the age rotation is getting shorter, at least you are making sure that the best trees for those sizes are going to the mean. So the stiffness to wood, they're actually there. Those trees actually have a value for the social and make sure that people doesn't break them. Anyway, Dolido.
I'm looking forward to system. Do you think that a technique like that being done in earlier stages of the forestry, like 40 years here, could help to address proper management to the forest, to specific goals that you have in the future?
Yeah, that's kind of part of the idea. If you have, let's say, a plantation, it will be easy because all of them will have more or less the same property. But we have different disciplining stands over here. So let's say we can plan better the thing because we are making sure that the less existing trees we are taking out of that. So because I'm not letting grow those woods, those trees are better for both. Or for other fruits that are not actually structural. It will affect all the managers because you can say this plant, they're probably the way that we plant the thing, and even pruning will be affected. So we have more information that we can decide. Instead of decide, let's do it by volume or baseball area, we can decide per actual thing, according to each product.
I'm just curious if you have an idea how this model can work in a tropical forest, in a natural forest with so many different variations.
Yeah, I would think it would work better, of course, in plantation. And some good temporary forest. It would be time for this kind of forest. In tropical forest, it would be hard because we have really marked species for structural. All these Sabebuya groups that really high density over 0.7, 0.8. So, you say it's not kind of necessity for that? Because at least in the way that we are using now for species. So, we are no Zapatero, Cuckoo Heart. It's really stiff, so you don't need to account for the stiffness. You know, it's going to support it. So, probably in it will be a really good tool for those of lower and mid, below price species. Then that should have a really specific market that is using for a specific market. That can use it like for everything, ebonitory or for a wood or for a tables. That can have a specific market. Maybe doing the sorting with this one, we can improve. To say, okay, these three species are better for ebonitory or handcrafting. These one are better for all the users. So, it's an interesting one. Of course, this is more to include our food or tempering work. But that was the idea how to do it. So you have to know the leaves of each tree. And so we need more research for that because we need to know like more or less average velocity of each one and how the behavior, the tool behave in each different tree. And it's different species.
You said that the time to improve
Yeah.
I was just wondering how far a data that are available.
DBH and MOE? And density? I can show you.
Thank you.
highly correlated. So maybe that's why we can substitute the deviation. But again, the problem here is not like the correlation between it, it's more applying operationalized tools. So the idea is to do the inventory in a good quality as fast as we can, you know, get the most information as fast and as cheaper as we can, but keeping the real statistics about this stuff. But yeah, you know how it's taken the good course, so it will take, I don't know, kind of the situation of the season. It will take 10 minutes, 20 minutes or more. And sometimes the board gets stuck, and so the smart guy decides to sell the tree, and then he knows it was like one of the other trees in the board. It's a story that happened in California. So yeah, it's a very easy choose, I think, deviation testing. It's just more practical. That's why most of these studies is doing a practical stuff for him.
Another question here. How about the cost if you compare with another methodology you said before? You have a different range of cost using this methodology, for instance, with the traditional way to
I don't have estimate. A real cost right now.
Because this could be a really interesting thing.
Yeah, but if you compare, for example, with the test frame machine, that is that big machine, but it's like going to have to move to the mill, so you have the installation, so it's like more processes. This is just by the, it's a small pot, like this size, where it won't put really portable. And if you see the pot, the guy has some, what do you say, some,
posters.
So it's like a, each sensor is going to the side, and the computer is going to the front. It's really portable, yeah. It's really portable tool. If you compare with the other ones, like silver scan and more glass tools.
Mm.
So this is the machine for static MOE. This is in glass condition. So it's big, it's really expensive, so we can move it like in the forest and moving around. It's not really portable. And of course, these three also are more lab situations, so it's not really portable, but it's more expensive. So in this way, the acoustic ones are providing the best portable and economic way. But you see, this is the tattoo, which is two probes, the hammer, and that's it. And the LM is more or less the same. So here's the album. So the two probes, the hammer, and the PDA, and a lot of batteries. But no more than that. So comparing cost with the actual bending machine, where you have to lumber, you have to saw it, you have to saw and then dry the wood to get the estimation of MOE. It's like it's a lot of work. The machine is expensive, also time consuming.
Yeah.
The same with this, it's still correct. So it's not really portable to something you will do. Obviously.
You can add that.
How accurate do you have to be when you're hitting on that the hammer? You know, do you have to be right on every time? And when you were doing your test,
it has a small overlap, so you won't miss it.
Actually, right there,
this is small from the prominent side. So you won't miss it.
Yeah. Why didn't you only try the model using the DDH? Why do not use basal area or the other
part? Basal area was basically because basically it's a function of DDH. P4 times. So it doesn't make sense to include the basal area in the model when I have DDH.
And the other one, the
to start high?
Uh-huh.
High was because when I run the model, it doesn't get actually any increase of also, I try like elevation, different, other different, let's say more ecological or ecological or climate ecological variable. So I use elevation, didn't get any good prediction from that.
you cry?
No, didn't cry age, because I don't have the age of each three. So I know that the span is between those age three, 70 and 75 years old, but I don't have the age of each three. It could be a good one, too. So we have to move forward to each three. It will be like that. We could do it, but if you have like a long-term plot, permanent plot that we can measure every time, maybe you can evaluate how the velocity is moving or how the velocity behaves according to the different age.
Okay. Yeah.
What's your question? Go ahead. Anyone else?
Nervous.
Great. Thank you.
Chupi.
Hola.
Saludos.
Hola.
Congratulations, un abrazo.
Ese es el pico. Ese es el pico, sí. Ese es
la novia. Felipe.
Es el pico, Chupi.
No. Él es el profesor Kevin.
Está escuchando.
Bueno, me van a caer a preguntas. Ah, yo te vi en la defensa cerrada y yo te vi en la defensa cerrada. Eso es todo, gracias por ver. Yo sé que muchos no entendieron
nada. Pero bueno, igualita
bien.
Bueno, amor, que te vaya bien.